People liberation movement actually had successful actions, and there were actually just 5 places in Belgrade, not more. But they are all not in public, part of the public memory. They are part of public history, and very small, but not all, not very. Sometimes they are mentioned or not in the books, but actually now in this moment in schools we have just like 1.5 pages about the Second World War. So all this is not part of public memory and public history, these places. And I was thinking in the beginning to do a kind of a guide because I expected that there are much more places like this. But they are not actually. And then when I saw that there are 5, I was thinking somehow how to do this guide, and then I thought to do it in a kind of immaterial monument, for example, which I thought later. But there were also many other reasons that I have done this and in this manner. And I was like there on the streets for 2 months, but at the same time, this was also not happening maybe every day, but I was. On the streets. And there's something. I don't want to speak more, but okay. I am not going to show many images. I had some friends who were insisting to take black and white photo with this old camera because this is somehow was so interesting for him as a photographer, and was very hype in this moment, like just almost, it's 8 years ago actually. And he was taking this in black and white, and I had some friends, other friends and relatives who took some photos, and also I have a relative who shoot the video also. But in the time when this happened actually, the anarcho-syndicalists, they were imprisoned. Because they had some unsuccessful action in the front of the Greek embassy on the 3rd of September 2010. They wanted to throw a Molotov cocktail, but then it didn't really work. And I don't know, the damage that they made was like 17 euro that they made at the window of the Greek embassy. But then they were imprisoned for 6 months. And they were accused actually for something that was so significant exactly for that time, and this was like international terrorism. And at the same time we were still looking for Karadzic. I think Mladic was already in Haag, but Karadzic was I think still not there. And all these countries, for example like Serbia, they were exercising in this moment how to deal with anti-terrorism and terrorism, how to deal with this in the terms of law and in terms of restrictions that are then what is terrorism, what not, what is. So for me it was somehow very important how to deal with this moment of the world divided between terrorists and anti-terrorists, where you didn't have actually another option. So I was interested, okay, is it possible now in this moment to have automatic weapon on the streets and not to be part of each of these two? So how to deal with this? How, and yeah, I will, maybe I can, these were, I don't have many photos, I mean I have, but I thought maybe it's not important to show all of them. I will show also video around this, but I want also to say something else. In the moment when the press was then somehow came to the material, which was posted in, I think, Art Daily, because during these two months there was one exhibition, and I posted a few photos there, and then they took it over. And then actually there was Politica, which is actually Politica is a daily newspaper, and then they took this, and this was actually no, this is not Politica. I don't have it here. Yes, here is Politica. So it was not part of the cultural pages, of the pages related to culture, but the so-called black pages, you know, black chronicles. So they were using my photo that they took from our daily to actually discuss this within the context of the black chronicles. And then this was then in Croatian returning list. And they discussed it from the position of an artist and compared with another artist, Slaven Toy, who had some other work which was like one could compare. So this was like more artistic context. And then it was also this really interesting 24 hours, which is like a newspaper that is daily, newspaper that is you don't pay for it, it is like. And they wrote very precisely about the anarcho-syndicalists. So everything what I said, they really published very, very precisely. And I was thinking, okay, if this work happens on the street, and if this work happens in the way I had an idea, because at the beginning, this was not part of the exhibition or part of the show that is like a group show or something. That was no institution that was behind me. And I thought at the beginning, because of the people who were like friends who were involved like photographing, I was thinking maybe it is good if I take some permission, but then I decided really not to take any permission from the police, because otherwise it would not have sense. I would want to say this was not that I knew from the beginning how I want to deal with this. It was like a lot of things that I thought about. And then after Dan was syndicalist being imprisoned, I wanted to somehow to devote this to them, especially also because of the title that I took over from them, because this is some kind of a part of the poem that is on their website and it is continuously like following them. As I said, that these are specific places, and I can maybe shortly. Yeah, I want also to show this. This is a guy who approached me like at this time, like in October. See, he said that it will be like 1 year when he approach, but I see here 2010. I don't know. So he met, and then he sent me some photos. And he took these photos while this happened. I will now just briefly show part of the video. Really very. And it would be nice if you tried to read the text that is after the.
Fašistička okupacija Evrope je razgovarao s mese otpor u skoro svim zemljama koje su bile okupirane. Ali taj, ti pokreti otpora nisu bili nisu intenzitivni, nisu praksni. Recimo u Poljskoj, da su se borile dve takozvane armije i u Francuskoj gdje je postao makijevski pokret, pa čak posle 43. godine i u Italiji, u Belgiji i nekim drugim zemljama, u Poljskoj i tako dalje. Ali Jugoslavija je imala jednu specifičnu situaciju jer je imala više nacionalnu zajednicu. I trebalo je pokrenuti jedan pokret protiv okupatora, a da se pokrenu svi narodi i, da kažem, i narodnosti te zemlje.
Komunistička partija je došla sa parolama koje je narod prihvatio, koje su bile i odgovarale su narodu.
Ustanak 41. To je također, ja mislim, jedan od ključnih događaja na teritoriji ove Jugoslavije, gdje je pod parolom smrt fašizmu, sloboda narodu, opet se narod ujedinio.
Jugoslavije i da se dođe do mira, a to je pokazala Jugoslavija koju su vi stvorili, da je 50 godina, ja mislim, retko kad u istoriji Jugoslavije da je toliko bila mirna, da je bila slobodna.
He has a street, and this is But okay, this is not a thematic of this.
But the book was about Kosovo and about colonization of Kosovo.
Yeah.
And genocide.
And genocide
between 1919 to 1921.
Yes. But whenever he published it, yes. Russia wrote a text about it. So whenever he published the book, the authorities would buy all copies.
Yeah. And they were banished from the
and
public.
He spent all his money, fortune, to publish again and again and again.
But 1956 in socialistic Yugoslavia he published.
Yeah. So and he was
in the same.
But this poem on love afterwards, this is one of the most beautiful poems on the people liberation struggle, and that actually talks about that aftermath thought on this. So I have it also here translated into English, maybe I can later read it.
But also the book, just to read the book, also questions the narrative that Yugoslavia was free for 50 years and things like that, which appears in the work.
Yeah.
Because it was more complex.
In the book.
In reality.
In reality. But in the book, but book took this over, I mean, yeah. This complexity. Yes. And the poem actually of, do you want to pose some questions so that we can, you know, start talking about this? Because maybe you're interested in something that I don't know now, and I will be happy to answer this.
I'm really curious to know about your plastic bag that you're carrying there.
Plastic
do you
bag.
Have it only for balance or?
Yeah, that's good. So the plastic bag has two roles. One is actually to have this normality of being on the street. And this like to take actually the weapon in the same way you would take a plastic bag or a purse. So or umbrella. So this is something, and what is also most important for me is actually that the weapon is not like an active, but that it is there, it can be activated, but it doesn't have to be. But it is there. So but the other role of the plastic bag, and thank you for this question, it was actually at that time the most of the whole chain of supermarkets that was actually the most was Maxi, and this was the owner was one of the let's say biggest capitalists in this moment after war capitalists. Mišković. So he was owner of all these chains, and there were women working at that time. This is this Maxi bag, actually. The women who were working there were mostly after they had more than 50 years, and they had to work like 10 to 12 hours a day, 28 days a month. Now it's they are working 10 hours, 28 days a month. And, but for some other people, not for Mišković. So, and it was very clever because all of them had more than 50 years, so they cannot leave the job so easy and get some another job. So, and they also had to be dressed in this plastic, you know, uniforms where they are like living advertising for some products that were them. So I was then 50 years old, and I decided actually to take this bag, plastic bag, in the name of my let's say, generation that was imprisoned in this supermarket chain. And yeah, this was the reason actually, two reasons that I
here or the police show up. I mean, I saw the gates of the bypasses. I mean, I see you hold the Kalashnikov in a way that you don't aim it. It looks, you hold it in a way not a soldier or someone who would like use the gun. Hold it. Then I guess you didn't carry a full ammunition magazine with you, so it was empty. Huh? But it was functional. I understand. Of course, in Germany, you would have had special police come to you, and it would be a very dangerous moment. But nobody interfered.
here I saw, I don't know if you...
But you don't translate, this is only in Serbocrat. The the letter of this guy. What is his motivation to...
But maybe now to answer this first.
Yes, of course.
There is this, I saw now when we were, because I didn't see this before. There is a police actually car. There is a police car, we can walk.
Okay, but they don't stop.
They didn't stop me. And this is, you know, this was actually, for me, so significant, because there are two things. I'm a woman, and they don't expect I have a gun. And they don't see this. And the second thing is actually that most of the people had experience with this same weapon, in the sense, or they were part of the war, or they rejected war and they went out of the country, or they were like voluntarily doing this, or they were mobilized. So everybody, so women have through their brothers, you know, through their husbands, friends, lovers, you know, they had also experience. So most of the people in Serbia had like contact with this weapon. But I think this is a kind of, especially, you know, now, but in 2010 there was no war. So there is no weapon also. So the weapon is invisible. I'm invisible also as a woman, because also regarding the Second World War, the women who were heroes, they were also somehow, you know, pushed aside, and you discuss just, you know, the victims of the Serbian people in this moment. Or you discuss the people who are fighting for the rights and for Serbia. And this was, women were not part of this last war. And this is important also. The role of the women was actually that they are in the media. They are in the media and they are somehow like in the entertainment business. So they have to make us forget that this weapon is being used. So having a woman, and I think this was my thought. But they were kids, like 13, 14 years old kids, who were the only one who looked somehow. And there was a guy, when I was sitting, like I had a pause, because I'm not about one all the time, so I was sitting, and there was a guy sitting next to me drinking some, you know, this small alcohol, vignette or something, and he asked me, he told me, hey, I know what, I told him, I don't know why, like, don't worry, I'm like just sitting. And he said, I don't worry, I know this, I was 154 days with this weapon. So he knows the exact day and that he spent. But I spoke to him, he didn't speak to me. But if we speak now about Germany or other Western European countries, like a year later, I was in Copenhagen and I was in Rome doing the same thing. Yeah, doing the same thing even for a day. It was for a day. And I will show you this. And I was, yeah. And I can maybe like kind of translate this slide. So this is Copenhagen. And people are driving bicycles. I don't have, but you have this photo where they're really like next to me or going in front. And there were also places in Copenhagen that were resistance of the people who were against the Nazi occupation, but it's not marked. So there were places also that are not part of history. And there were also places in 1993 where people didn't want to join actually European Union, and they made a huge demonstration, but they were like with the rubber bullets, and about 17 people were injured on this. And it is also not part of public memory. It is on this bridge. So these were kids going also with me And so I have also the police who also come passing by. But the only woman who actually approached me was in this Western Bureau, which is a part where immigrants are and also prostitutes or junkies. So this is a, some kind of a, you know, porno shops are there, but there is a very important place where actually a Nazi, against Nazi occupation, it started in 43, but it was blown up actually, it was, they exploded this place, but there is also no mark, and there is no historical plate or something, you know, that can show. So this woman was actually, she was interested if it's full or not, and she was worried actually if something can happen, but she was really worried. I had a feeling she really wants to have this in there. But she wanted to see if it's full or not. This was her, and she was the only who approached me. It was a woman, and she was somehow like excluded from this, like main society, and she was the only one that was interested in this. And she was looking how is it, yeah, loaded or not. And here, you see this guy here. This behind. Yeah. This guy is actually, he approached me also, and he told me, listen, I know this guy. This is like, again, the same story. I know this guy, I'm coming from Turkey, but I was paid soldier in Iraq, so he was paid. And he said, and I earned some money, and now I opened the kebab shop in Copenhagen. So for me, so if I'm on the street with this, and we know that there is a huge issue around what is public space and not. Does it exist? Is it privatized? But with this, I'm asking myself, you know, when we have this guy who actually now lives in Copenhagen, he has to forget his history. So what happened? Do we establish some kind of a inner, you know, public space that opens in a different way in memory of a guy who actually opens his old history there on the side where he has to forget, you know, because he's in Copenhagen and he has to forget this and actually to run this kebab shop, like he's ethical, but he is actually from Turkey, has nothing to do with the war where he was paid, but this whole journey, just this weapon made him aware about this, and just this weapon, like, brought this history back. So it's not just about the public, but it's also about the memory and the suppressed, you know. What is suppressed? And we know that these guns are somehow really important part of this world. They are now much advanced, but actually all these countries from where we come, this gun is somehow was used. These are guys, for example, kids, like, they're 17, 18 years coming from Afghanistan in Rome. They're, this is a very long gun that I got in Rome. But they're refugees who are now fighting for actually Gaza at the moment. But they can move a bit. But yeah, this is these are different places. And this is also, like, I don't know what is the relation between these two persons. But I was also in these places, which is actually, which were also not marked in law. And I have to say, like, walking on the streets in this manner, you see also how the space is open or not for this kind of, you know, I was also not approached in law. But it was really a one day, I don't know what would happen.
Is the camera in front of you moving, visible? Or?
No. No. The camera is not visible.
So especially shot from far away?
Always. I mean, this was my friend David who actually left Yugoslavia because of the war. So everybody also involved in this, the people who were cameramen, or they were somehow involved in the whole story also connected with this weapon. And it is also about the restriction of the public space. So now the question, would this be possible now? Of course not. Maybe not, I don't know. I'm curious if it would be, you know, how... there was a moment in Belgrade when this Medved came actually from Russia. He was like visiting Serbia and this was police everywhere. And this would, they were controlling everything. This was really like a, I don't know if they would, you know, see you and shoot. And then there was like a few months after, there was a guy going with a weapon and he was arrested in the moment. This was happening like a few months later.
Maybe they've seen your camera and they thought you're acting or something.
There is no camera. There was no camera. The camera was really fun.
It's normal that you're arrested if there is a gun. I mean, police must do the job, you know. That's how it goes.
But the camera...
I would be worried if nobody would be arrested. Like, you're going with guns over the gun.
Yeah. You mean now?
Yeah, of course, but always, you know.
But of course. So we have two more in
our... No, just a soul.
I'm interested about the connection with art or syndicalism.
Yeah, I'm thinking now about that, you know.
Yeah, what's the connection?
Yeah, the connection is that they were arrested on the 3rd of September for international terrorism, because Europe, actually they were to employ these new laws that are around how to, you know, how to deal with terrorism in this moment. So they were arrested as international terrorists. And they were accused also for this. And they were sitting in a jail like for 6 months. And they were, it was a huge process. I mean, really huge process going on with them.
He's ended the last year.
Hmm? He ended the last year. Year. So yes. It was for 7 years, or 8 years going on.
How
is it possible to connect anti-fascism struggle with anti-fascism
today?
This is
for me, like, how do you connect both?
I don't connect both. Because this work is so much, it is so much actually about, you know, it is so much about this, how actually the public space is being, let's say, squeezed and restricted in a way we can use this. And actually, what is the, today we know this, but in 2010 actually, and even earlier, the whole idea of the war against terror actually changed the idea of the war. So we have like Clausewitz as a concept of war, which is like politics with armed means, but then with the concept of anti-terrorism dividing the world in terrorists and anti-terrorists, so we have what we have then, we have actually whole states, religions, and also individuals being like outlawed. They're actually on the other side and everything can happen to them. So, because they are defined as terrorists. So there are no more, any kind of relations, but terrorists or not terrorists. And we know today that everybody can be accused of being a terrorist. And there are, you know, mistakes, not mistakes, and this is something that is, so this is like a global war, a continuous war. And this idea of maybe, you know, having in mind another politics, which was, for example, the anarcho-syndicalists, they actually, their terrorist act was in favor and actually in support of the anarchists in Greece in this time and the whole demonstrations that were going on in 2010. And, you know, for me this paradox, you know, to have a really international terrorist and criminal which is like Karadžić being in peace somewhere, and on the other side, like taking these kids who were all like between 18 and 22, taking them into prison as international terrorists is really like an abnormal situation. But we have this situation like as a very normalized today. And like bringing these two together, I can devote this, but not really bring this together. But for me, it was important in order to question also this relation and the world that is divided between these two sides, like terrorists and anti-terrorists. It's a bipolar situation. Sabina, yeah.
Maybe we can take some questions if anyone has. Yeah.
Oh, one day. One day instead of locks and latch. Oh, one day instead of one night, a burst of machine gun will flash if light cannot come otherwise. Umesto rao, boski, kola, umjesto gladi, umjesto suza. Ah, jednog dana, umjesto bola, umjesto tuge i umjesto uza. Ah, jednog dana, umjesto pljačke i pandura, umjesto kralja, umjesto kneza. Ah, jednog dana, umjesto bura, umjesto rata, umjesto proteza. Ah, jednog dana, umjesto brava i umjesto reza. Ah, jednog dana, umjesto noći, ljesni će rapali iz mitraljeza, kad drug će svetlost ne može doći. Ah, jednog dana, jednog dana. Kad bukne ruža mesečina i sunce srca, drugovi moji, a njima slobode i mašine, ko ljubav što me s devojkom spoji, ah, jednog dana, jednog dana. Biće sve lepo i neizbežno i strašno, bit će ko duša blaga i kad je toplo i kad je susnežno, življenje bit će svima ko draga jednog dana, jednog dana. I'm sorry that not everybody could understand, but it is not translated actually. And it is actually a song, a poem that was wrote from the side of Oskar Davičo, his poem, in a memory of, he was imprisoned together with Robert Svetozar, who was a great fighter and also ideologist of another world and another concept of living at the very beginning of the century. They were together in prison around the 20s. To read this because I thought it's important. The poem is actually much longer.
Can I ask about the places where you walked in Belgrade and then in other cities? Was it also connected to the community that happened in the
place? Yeah, this was. Thank you for asking this. So there were different places and really very important actually for example, the one which is here, so they were different. There is one street which is called Botičeva street, and this was a house of Ribnica family who were part of the war, and the historic session actually of Politburo, the Central Committee that was on the Communist Party that was held, and the resulting actually the decision to start the uprising against the occupation. And they started this in Botičeva Bay, so five. So this is such an important place to somehow mark this house as is a place where the anti-fascist struggle started. So this was one place. Another was the corner of Cvičeva and Rezotova street, where today we have a big big shopping mall called Zara, and there was a really big garage at the time of Ford, where during the Second War in the 41, there was actually the illegal forces, which were actually part of the People Liberation Movement. This garage exploded and they ruined everything that was there. And they were illegals actually that had made this, and this was in July 16, in 41. But there is also no plate, no historical evidence about this. It was just part of the, it was very often, and it was actually part of this TV series called Otpisan. I don't know how that we all watched. So it was part of the film. And of TV, you know. But it is not. So then we have one really important moment, and this is actually the killing of the special police agent, whose name was Kosmajac, and his colleague Zalat, who were very like infamous characters, who were killing the communists, and they were imprisoning them, and then going through huge tortures, etc. So the people who were illegals, the part of the movement, of the People Liberation Movement, they organized the whole setting, actually waiting for him and killing him. They were organizing. There was a girl who was like with milk bottles, like waiting for him, and then giving a sign like taking these bottles and making lamb them. Then there were her colleagues, actually they came, and so he was killed. So there was a whole installation like in a theater how to do this. And then it was actually one of the most interesting, this was under the Brancos Bridge. This is this, actually the old bridge, where this bridge was actually when the Germans with forces, like the SS division withdrew. They withdrew to the northern Serbia and they went over the bridge, and their idea was actually for the bridge to explode. And this guy, he was an old professor, Zaric, who was sitting on his like window looking at this, and he saw what they're doing, and because he has experience in the First World War, he decided actually to run and to disable the wires, the dynamites, actually to explode. So he saved this bridge, for example, when they went, the bridge was saved. And he was, I don't know, already 60, 70 years old. And this is really, you could say, okay, he wasn't a communist, maybe they should, you know, if we are today, like the whole country somehow not, somehow wanting to forget this past and to go into different kind of economical and social relations, but he was an ordinary citizen, so he could have at least the plate of this. But yeah, so this is also kind of a...
But he didn't have a plate even during Yugoslavia, I guess, right?
No.
So it's about the new system, it's about that these places were never marked, right?
Yeah, but not all of them. They were placed, they were marked. There was also a printing house that I didn't mention. There was a printing house where all the paint, the flyers and everything that was in the newspapers, this was also placed on the, and it was marked, but today it isn't. Even this mark, this plate that was there, it stands today behind the wardrobe in the sleeping room of this family, because they are afraid actually to put this on the, they don't want actually to have anything with this. But actually maybe private memory in the sleeping room.
Okay. If there are no more questions, I'll just thank you for the presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.